So Lord Iltari has a subscribe star also known as the Paladin. I would really recommend anyone who's invested in this story to go over and check it out. It's a solid way to help support the author and help get stories like this written, so check out the top link in the description. Though let's start, will we? Be me, Paladin, creator of some seriously sick bastards, but not quite as many as Undri's player when she DMS. Be the Paladins of Order reunited, Kazdor the Bloodroth, Julian the War Master, Senkit the Valkyrie, Undri the Moon Touched, and Peregrine the Scalibreaker. Be the Chain Devil currently getting curb stomped into the ground by said party after being surprised by them while trying to recapture Kazdor. As that remarkably unfortunate chitin tries to push itself to its feet, Peregrine runs between Undri and Senkit's legs and leaps onto his back, driving his blades into his spine. The devil flickers as it starts to lose its grasp on the world. Then it sees Vengeful Spirit, and reconsiders, vanishing back to the hells perhaps a bit quicker than it needed to. The party looks up from the battle, glad to be done with that devil. There's grins all around as they reunite with their lost friend, but he raises a talon to stop them, turning back to the kobold lying on the floor. The party breaks off the celebration and moves quickly to help. Undri examines her carefully as she lays healing magic upon her. Multiple broken bones, torn ligaments, fairly standard torture injuries. She mutters carefully. Looks like there's some lingering poison in her bloodstream as well, damn drow. She layers on a spell to nullify the poison, and then raises her hand to the kobold's head. I stopped the bleeding, but I can't regenerate her tongue. These burns won't heal either. Julian steps in and examines the marks. These are ritual markers, but they don't match up with any spells I've seen. No, wait, the others had these marks too, it's some kind of implanted spell. Bast. Analyze the lab. While Julian examines his patient, the familiar surveys the laboratory. Bottles and bottles of this clearly magical red substance, and they are warm to the touch. More and more of these strange orange leathery parchments as well. The cat smirks as it sees a book on top of a high counter. Dragonborn, get that for me. It says, and the party starts in surprise. Yes, I can talk, there is simply very little worth saying most of the time, now get me the book. Cass somewhat sheepishly gets the book down for the cat, who begins to pour through it. My, this fellow was up to some remarkably nasty business here. It mentally purrs to Julian. Though it is remarkably clever, perhaps a bit too clever. So what is it exactly? Self-regenerating short-term magical effect, soul bonded to a user. It looks like he was trying to create a permanent effect with it, but that always failed. Primary components are imp skin and dragon blood. Impressive work. Too impressive. Something with substantial magical knowledge and power would need to be actively working to make them function properly. The glyphs are incomplete. So it's similar to a warlock's spells. Almost identical, except the pact is forced on someone, with more limited benefits to cost. Right, how do I get it off and what would the price be of using one of these? Probably could be removed like any other curse. As far as you using it, the bonding process would be agonizing, but the glyphs could be completed with sufficient time and research. Damn, and he put five of those things on her at once. Julian curses. That's either the height of foolishness or sadism. Most assuredly sadism. Undri confirms. He was a drow after all, those scum a little better than the demons they cavort with. In that we are in agreement. I can get those things off her, but it will take more time and magic than we have available at the moment. I'd suggest we leave her here and come back for her when we leave. Julian advises. Right then, let's get going. That Drake is a lot to answer for. Kaz rumbles. Julian hands him the axe he dropped back several days ago, and Kaz takes it gratefully. Undri removes her cloak and covers the kobold, leaning her back against the wall and whispering a prayer over her. There is a flicker of bending moonlight, much to even Undri's surprise, as the kobold vanishes invisibly. The Inquisitor offers a prayer of thanks, though to the wrong goddess. In the unseen plane, a dark mother watches her daughter proudly, though she mourns her loss and the hate in her. As they go to depart, Julian examines several of the existing implantation scrolls, and takes them with him. Kazdor and Senkit are the last to leave, and as they go, Sen places a hand on his shoulder. The Dragonborn turns, and Senkit grabs him in a close embrace. Don't go getting yourself captured again, you big oaf, she tells him. I'll do me best, lassie. He responds, hugging her back, and then they get moving again. The party returns to the junction, and head down the last unexplored path. This leads to another spiral stairway leading up. Heading up it, they come to the next floor. The stair leads up further, and the hallway continues in two separate directions ahead of them. They take the left path. This path leads back to another door. Cass kicks it open, and they find what might best be described as a nest of chains. Dozens of them wrapped together, coming out of holes in the floor and walls. This was clearly a chain devil's room. From here he could interface with all the chains across the entire lair and sense any and all movements throughout it. They don't find anything of value. Heading back across the hall to the other room, they find another room. Entering into this one, they find that it has a rather large hole in the ceiling, one approximately dragon-sized. It is a far larger room, but clearly not the hall chamber. Instead they find in here a large collection of glass shards inside a circle, with five burning candles around it. Well, this is a devil summoning room if I've ever seen one, and I've seen more than a few. Andre mutters. This dragon really has a thing for cliches, doesn't he? Peregrine mutters. I mean, really, a pentagram drawn in blood with candles at the end to summon devils. He's really playing into the tropes. In this case it's less about the trope and a lot more about the actual magic behind it. The reason you draw pentagrams in blood is because that makes it significantly more effective for binding, especially if you use your own blood. As for the candles, those are focuses and also probably alarms as well if he knows what he's doing. Julian explains. The others give him a, why do you know so much about summoning devils, look. He gives them an exasperated sigh. My mother was a witch, we summoned devils on a fairly regular basis. Honestly, considering what we do, I'd think you'd become a little less afraid of the occult by now. Less afraid, more cautious. It's not something to be trifled with. Senkit cautions. Be that as it may, this is ultimately just more magic. It's powerful stuff and no mistake, but it's ultimately the same force that we use on a daily basis. This time it just happens to be used to conjure devils rather than banish them. Julian shrugs it off. I mean, come on, I have God's damned angel wings, you're half devil, we've been to a different plane of existence, and fight armies of ghosts, demons, undead tentacle monsters, and evil spaghetti on a daily basis. We really shouldn't be that worried when we find more supernatural nonsense at this point. Kazdor chuckles. Ye have a fair point there, laddie, but let's knees to tact in, foolish either. Well, it's not like I'm going to wander over and knock over the candles or something. Julian says. And despite all laws of literature saying something ought to go horribly wrong immediately after that, nothing happens. The party continues to examine the circle from various angles. What do you think of all the glass in the center? Possible material to form a gateway? Andre asks. Probably, though if it was I'd have expected to see a lot more lesser devils, lemures and the like. Julian muses as the two circle the circle. Enough chatter, how do we destroy it? Senkit asks. The last thing we need is him calling in some sort of diabolical backup. Under ordinary circumstances I'd say we should just rip apart the circle, but that glass has me concerned. The circle's still active as well, so there's going to be some rather nasty backlash if we just take a sword to it. Well, if the glass is a problem, how about just moving it out? Peregrine suggests. If you feel like stepping inside the active pentagram to do that, be my guest. Julian says sarcastically. We need to shut it down and more than that, nullify its effects. If the glass is a problem, we can catch it while it's in the circle and banish it while taking down the effect. Something like this probably took a week to build. Andre, ye've experience in dealing with heretics, ye run into a thing like this? Kaz asks, pacing nervously. He was already fairly distrustful of magic to begin with and was painfully aware of how dangerous devils could be. Andre examines the circle again, this time far more closely, and then realizes something. There's runes here. She exclaims, pointing at the circle. It was indeed not actually a circle, but a series of tiny runes wound together in the shape of a circle. Julian gets next to her and examines them, then grins. It's a damn good thing we didn't just smash it. That could have gone very badly indeed, but with these, give me some time to transcribe it and I can create a counter ritual. If we boost that with our own magic, we can completely disable this, and long term as well. Julian gets out his quill and spellbook and begins transcribing the circle onto the paper. After he has the runes, he and Andre sit down and begin debating the counter spell to exorcise it. While they work, Senkit looks at the circle and paces uncomfortably, her long tail swishing back and forth on the ground, arms crossed, a grim look on her face. Like she's chewing on a bitter memory. Cass comes alongside her. You're a wee bit too familiar with this sort of witchery, aren't ye? He asks. Far too familiar. Senkit replies. She looks at the two working on the exorcism. I imagine Seer Buckethead probably already knows exactly why, and Andre probably figured it out as well. Her voice is bitter, and somewhat resigned. Like a child who knows that they have committed a wrong and is just waiting for their parents to castigate them for it. I, Un's clever, and Julian cleverer than is good for him. Kaz agrees. But Avni got her eyes o' his head. I'm afraid ye'd have to tell me directly. Senkit shakes her head and sighs. And have you look at me the same way as everyone else too? No. She looks down. You and the rest are the first people I've met since Master Arvidor left who don't look at me like what I am, and I don't want to give that up. Kaz lays a hand on her shoulder and clenches it tightly. Lass, I do look at ye the way ye are. And I'll beat the living daylights out o' anyone who sees ye and thinks ye're anything less than one o' the bravest, most honourable, most self-sacrificing women I've ever met. And quite frankly, if ye when ye am a friend I'd beat the hell out o' ye for thinking so lowly of me that ye think I'd ignore all that if I ken where ye came from. She turns to him and sees hurt in his eyes, in his stance, even subtly in his remarkably rigid face, and feels ashamed. She opens her mouth to speak, but Julian interrupts her. We've got the exorcism done, he says as he stands up, walking over with Unri towards the circle. Kazdor and Senkit Sherry, we'll speak of this later. Glance. Good, let's get rid of this thing and move on. She says, the mask of the Iron Valkyrie coming back on. The elf and the Arsima take their places on opposite sides of the circle and begin to chant. Julian speaks, and the power of Arcana flows from his words, rooting into the construct before him and disrupting it, loosening its grip on the world. Undri speaks, and her words call the earth to action, as the power of the natural world forces out the intrusion. They speak as one, words of power. To bind and to banish, to constrain and to cast out, to exorcise and eliminate the power of the Hells from their grip on their world. Their words take hold, and the infernal script lifts up off the floor, falling away and being consumed by tongues of emerald and indigo fire. It is working, throwing away the ritual and locking the door behind it. Then the glass takes notice, and the being who grants the glass life takes notice. Julian and Undri sense it first, a tremendous power that their magic fades off of like rolling waves upon a smooth stone. Then all the rest sense it, and feel a burning in their bones and taste brimstone on their tongue. Julian's eyes go wide as he realizes just what they've run into, and he goes for his sword, plunging at the rising matrix of infernal script and glass which is beginning to form into a humanoid shape. With horns, a thick tail, and huge, bat-like wings. Kaz, Undri, Peregrine, and Senkit all go for their weapons as they prepare for the fight. Then Julian stops. And Kazdor stops. And Peregrine stops. Everything stops. The wind, the falling droplets of water dripping from stalactites onto the floor, frozen in midair, the heartbeats of every paladin. Except for Senkit. Senkit, who watches in the world of stop time as the glass forms itself into the crude simulacra of a devil, one with proud, handsome features, mighty wings, horns ablaze like a yule tree with fire, and a mace in one hand. It is a crude image of a devil she knows very, very well. Father, she says, shield and morning star raised, as the image of Zarathustra, Duke of the Iron Circle, turns towards her, and his scowling face gives way first to wonder, then to joy. Little one, he says, approaching her slowly. She keeps her guard up, despite his smile. Can it really be, after all these years? The glass pit fiend stops, and reaches out a hand towards her, but Senkit flinches back. You have become the spitting image of your mother, minus my horns of course. He says fondly. Oh how I wish she could see you now. The fates are kind today. He says, almost laughing. It isn't a maniacal laugh, but more of a hearty belly laugh that sounds more like it belongs on Saint Nick than a devil. He looks at his daughter, still guarded, glaring at him from behind her shield. Two pairs of golden eyes lock, and his smile fades. I see. I imagine you hate me now. You were so young, he shakes his head. 20 years, that's how long it's been on this plane now, hasn't it? Gods, you're almost 30, you could have children of your own by this point. Apologies, but your bloodline ends with me. Senkit snarls back. This one anyways. The devil looks at her and sighs, then sees the shield. Ah, is all he says, but that single syllable contains more vitriol and wrath than 1,000 words of ranting. He looks at Senkit and looks into her, sees what her soul has become and is horrified. Oh my beloved daughter, what have they done to you? He draws near to her again, and this time she doesn't move. Instead, when the image of her father reaches out to touch her, she steps forwards, raises her mace high, and brings it down on the glass devil's face, smashing it and throwing it back. The spell breaks, and time flows again. They have made me more than the consequence of my mother's degeneracy. She snarls, and hits him again, this time with her shield. The image of the devil laughs as it braces against the attack and screeches slightly back. Senkit's wings again with her mace, and Zarathustra parries with enough force to jar her shoulder. It's only an imitation, but it is still damnably strong. Julian is the first to react, seemingly already knowing where the glass devil was even after the time stop. He rushes the devil's flank with his sword raised and brings it down. The idol catches the blade and examines it. A bad blade. How did you know? It's been modified, it says grinning. Julian smites the creature, cracking its hand apart and throwing it back. So, you're the one. Fascinating. The idol takes two arrows in the neck and gives Undri an annoyed glare, then turns to deal with Peregrine, who goes to town on its knees. Zarathustra sweeps down, but Peregrine jumps back, then onto the mace, running up it to ram his sword down the construct's throat. You're an agile little one. The devil mutters, ability to speak seemingly unimpeded. Kazdor rushes in and it swings at him as he attacks. Kaz catches the mace, muscles bulging to hold the construct's unnatural might back. He chops into the hand at the wrist twice and manages to sever it, then takes the mace and smashes the construct in the chest with it. Zarathustra goes sliding back across the stone floor, visibly falling apart but still laughing. Wonderful, and magnificent. My dear, your technique is on point, and your choice of companions is wise indeed. You have done quite well for yourself, all things considered. Senkit isn't listening, instead she charges the idol and smashes it in the face, knocking Peregrine free and smashing the head back. I am very proud of you. Are Zarathustra's last words to his daughter before she crushes the statue's face and reduces it to dust. Kaz keeps the mace though and puts it on his belt. So, I take it that was what ye meant to tell me about? Whatever god controls fate is a bitch, but yes. Senkit snarls as she puts back her own mace. That was my father, or at least something he was using to talk through. Now you know, I suppose. Oh, I've known for quite a while. Julian says as he puts away his sword. I mean, you do have his surname, and I do know a thing or two about devils. Senkit stares at him, somewhat shocked. What, you think I was going to confront you about it or tell everyone? You and I might get along about as well as baking soda and vinegar, true, but I figured it was your own business. You didn't get to pick your father any more than I did mine. At least yours seems to give a damn about you. Not to interrupt the heartwarming moment, but, Peregrine says as he points upwards. I think combat was not exactly a stealthy move. The party looks up to see Avernius lounging at the hold above them, head in a claw like a human might have when they're lying on a couch watching a telenovela. If they made dragon-sized popcorn, you can bet he'd have a bowl of it to chew on. Run. Undri suggests. Run. Avernius agrees. Be me, Paladin, puppet master of many a monster and villainous foe. Be Kazdor the Avenger, Julian the Conqueror, Peregrine the Redeemer, Senkit the Devoted, and Undri of the Ancients, Paladins of Order Undivided. Be Avernius the Burning Lord, actively trying to turn them into the Paladins of Order barbecued. The dragon's jaws fly open, and blue hot fire rips out with the sound of a rushing wind, a blindingly brilliant cone of superheated gases focused down on the party. The paladins scatter. Senkit throws herself between the flames and Undri, warding them off with her shield, the magic crackling indigo as it struggles to hold out against the heat. Undri retreats, mostly unscathed thanks to Sen's intervention, though she's still mildly burnt from the heat. Kazdor and Julian activate their wings and dodge upwards, flying out to where the cone is narrower and getting almost entirely clear. Peregrine, on the other hand, has no shield and very few places to run to. The flames hit him dead on, but by some strange twist of fate he comes out mostly unscathed, although his swords now glow a cherry red from the flames, and the bone hilts are blackened. Undri shakes her head to clear her blurring vision from the sudden light and takes aim. Two silver arrows fly true into the huge dragon's bulk, but even the keen-eyed archer cannot pierce his thick scales and bounce off uselessly. Peregrine realizes that he and Sen are sitting ducks down here, and with no way to climb up to the hall chamber. He waves for her to follow him and the two dash back down the corridor towards the staircase, hoping to find a way up. As for Kazdor and Julian, they face the dragon head-on to keep it from chasing down their flightless comrades. Kazdor, strongest of armed with his savage axes, manages to land a blow that breaks through the scales, but it is only a flesh wound. Julian has little more in the way of luck, flying to above the dragon and plunging downwards, lacerating the beast's wings in the process. Avernius rolls in the air, gashing Kazdor, but fine dwarven mail holds against sharp talons. The dragon's tail lashes out, hitting Julian in the chest and throwing him into the piles of treasure. Julian's inferior armor comes apart from the force of the impact, one of his gauntlets completely shaking apart and falling off. Mere flesh wounds. I must admit, of all the mongrels I have faced over these centuries, you are the first to achieve this. In your final moments, take pride that you have pierced the flesh of a god. Avernius mocks the paladins. Dragonthemed.mp3. Undri places a finger to her arrow as she draws it back. Swift death to my enemies. She hisses, and lets it fly. The arrow flies true, striking the dragon in the side of the head. There is clap of thunder that shakes the cavern and resounds off the walls, smashing the burning lord's head to the side like the fist of a titan. The dragon finally notices the elf and snarls. You bring magic? Very well, so shall I, he sneers, and four glowing orbs form around his head, and then dive into the hole. Undri dives clear, but the fireballs consume the entire room, leaving her no place to dodge as she's blasted off her feet and falls on her arms and legs, charred badly. Julian struggles to his feet and the dragon eyes him. With a flicker of will, Avernius commands his horde, and the golden weapons roll out like a wave and crash down on the Arsima, burying him in a pile of valuables. He's a caster then, eh? Julian mutters, pushing up just enough to reach into his bag and grab an imp skin scroll. Fine then. He looks for something to bind the parchment and a golden gauntlet catches his eye. It is fashioned like a talon, with sharp points. There are 6 sapphires set into it, gleaming with magical light. That will do. Peregrine and Senkit make it up the staircase and run for the largest door they can find, throwing it open just in time to see Kazdor locked in a desperate struggle with Avernius. The dragon appears to be trying to clap Kazdor between 2 claws, and Kaz is just barely holding him off. The dragon bites down, and sends Kaz flying back into the group. Peregrine fires his sling and Senkit hurls a bolt of hellfire, but neither has any effect. Avernius chuckles as he readies another boosted fireball, but then stops when the spell ceases, and the swirling orbs blow away in an unseen wind. Avernius turns, and sees Julian standing proud, a gleaming stigmata on his arm with the crimson light of his commanding path. Counterspell, bitch. The burning lore draws and falls upon Julian like a whirlwind of fangs and talons. Julian fends off the first attack, but the second rends through his breastplate and tears his chest open. He tries to fly free but Avernius grabs his wings and his talons and shakes like a dog trying to kill a rat, before flying upwards and hurling the Arsima into the ceiling. Julian flies upwards in a spray of Icha and falling feathers before smashing into a stalactite with enough force that the stone crumbles. His right arm loses all feeling, as does everything below his stomach, his spine shattered in 2 places and wings dispelled. His eyes glaze over, and he almost passes out, but he clenches his teeth and his fist as he lets out 9 hells of a counterpunch. Julian activates every charge in the gauntlet of storms at once, lashing out with a titanic bolt of lightning that frames Avernius in electricity. The dragon screams in pain and its muscles lock. Dragon and paladin fall to the ground with an arch-shaking crash. Meanwhile, Undri pulls herself to her feet, choking on the ash, eyes red from the smoke. In spite of this and the burns, she looks up with a new arrow drawn. When she sees the dragon has moved, she touches her finger to her arrow. Vines sprout from it, wrapping around her arm before she lets it fly. The arrow lodges in the ceiling like a grappling hook, and the vines constrict, hauling the elven woman up just in time to see Julian and Avernius fall. With the dragon down, even temporarily, the paladins take their chance and charge. Kazdor makes it there first, striking the burning lord from above. Avernius whirls in anger as the axes bite into him and conjures several scorching rays, which lance up at the dragonborn. Sivrid takes control, empowered by the wounded dragon's blood, rising into the air and weaving Kazdor through the onslaught unscathed. Senkit charges in, Mesa light with holy fire and lays into the beast. Blessed by her devotion, the morning star rips through the dragon's scales like paper. Roaring in fury, he turns and blasts her with the full might of his fire. The enchanted shield holds, but barely, and the force of the blast pushes Senkit back out of reach. Peregrine rushes in close behind her. Fastball special. He calls, and Senkit nods, ducking her shield. Peregrine leaps atop it, scorching his bare feet on the hot metal, but he endures. Working together, Senkit launches the halfling at the dragon. He lands on the drake's massive head and flips his swords, still hot from the flames, around. Driven by fate as much as the halfling's skill, the swords both strike home into the burning lord's left eye, and dark power surges, withering away the eye, weakening the bone, and striping the scales to leave it nothing more than a skeletal socket. For any other creature that would have been an instant and inescapable death. But this was no mere creature. This was a dragon, in the flower of his youth and the cusp of adulthood, and Peregrine's short blades could not reach his brain. As such, the wound was terrible, but not enough. You wretched, tiny, insignificant mongrel. Avernius roars in agony, and his rage makes his entire body light up like a supernova. Peregrine's tunic catches fire on contact with it and his feet blacken. The dragon throws back its half-skull head and throws Peregrine off. The dragon's ire, in form of fire, laid low the halfling, his blades and mail. Peregrine falls, tunic obliterated, chainmail falling off him in chunks, hair burned off, skin blackened, and his swords melted to useless slag. As he falls though, passing from life, he brings death with him while the door is open. A single finger trails along the dragon's chest as the halfling falls, and withers the once invincible scales to dust, stripping Avernius of his armor in a last act of defiance to give his party a chance. The party watches him fall, even Julian, who barely can see out of one eye, drifting in and out of consciousness. Avernius sees their shock, and thinks for a moment that he has broken their spirits. He could not be more wrong. Paladin's theme, Lament for Peregrine Edition. Andrea's the first to act, seizing a magic arrow from her quiver, and drawing her bow back with such force. Her rage and grief pours into the bow and arrow, as she hisses her curse. Slow, agonizing death to those who oppose me. She releases, and the bowstring snaps from the force. The arrow flies true though, striking the joint where the wing meets the shoulder. The arrow strikes like a spider's fang and the magic explodes outwards, first a physical force that tears the wing out of its socket and nearly off, second an insidious poison that burns through the dragon's veins. Senkit follows through, striking Avernius's head back and forth like a ping pong ball, knocking out two of his fangs. Die. And be devoured by 10,000 demons. She curses him. Even blooded so he is still mighty and throws her off with the headbutt. Julian stands up. His body is broken, there is no way for his brain to communicate with his legs or his right arm, but even still, he stands up. He is surrounded by whirling scarlet energies, his will made real and supporting him beyond the limits of flesh. The path to mankind's salvation is stained crimson by the blood of heroes. Peregrine understood that, and he gave it well. Even still, his blood cries out for vengeance. Julian raises his vengeful spirit, around him is the will of an invincible conqueror. I will answer. I will make a throne from your skull. He screams, foaming at the mouth, and charges. He does not run, but, more slides, driven by magic rather than muscle, and drives his blade through the dragon's weakened chest to the hilt. How's that for a flesh wound? He hisses, before ripping the blade free, disgorging everything he has into a single attack that leaves him unable to move. But tears apart the dragon's chest like a meteor. The dragon falls back, mortally wounded, but still with fire in his belly. Avernius opens his jaws to try to bring one more paladin into the grave with him, but something hits him from his left side. Castor, flying in from the dragon's blind spot, channels the might of his gods into the axe he has firmly planted in the dragon's left eye socket. The gods answer, and the sound of an anvil splits the dragon's skull open. Castor leans back and raises both axes high. For Peregrine. He roars, and delivers both axes directly into the dragon's brain. The dragon's head explodes in a squall of gore, and the stump of the neck fountains blood onto Castor and Sivrid. The magical item surges in power as it drinks in the magic of the dead beast. Castor couldn't care less though. He rushes to Julian's side, laying his hands on the still Arsimer's form. Nee, I'm nee losing another friend today. He promises. Julian's eyes flicker open, and he tries to move. Stay still, laddie. Castor orders him. No, Peregrine. Julian rasps. Scroll. There's still time. The Arsimer starts dragging himself towards the halfling's charred body. He's dead, lad, there's nee more ye can do for him. Cass tries to console Julian, who stubbornly refuses to give up. Andri moves to try to help him, when her eye catches a sparkle of light coming from a scroll, still unscathed sticking out of Peregrine's pack. For when the day is darkest. She remembers the inscription, and runs for the scroll, pulling off the seal and unrolling it, smiling as a single diamond falls from it. Resurrection music. Peregrine opens his eyes in a small but cozy room, the sort you entertain guests in when the main hall is still being prepared. He looks around and sees an old halfling sitting in a chair, smoking a pipe, and watching him. The man is clad all in grey, and has withered, skeletal hands that look diseased. Peregrine's eyes widen as he realizes who he's looking at, but before he can speak, Avery does. So, are you done? The withered guard asks his follower. Done. There's still the dragon, Kaz and Mayo. Peregrine says, as he looks down at his body and sees his hands are translucent. I'm dead. He says, somewhat surprised. Yes, you're dead. Avery says, somewhat crossly. That isn't what I asked. I asked if you were done. What? There's still the dragon to deal with, I've still got my friends to help, there's still the abbey to protect. There will always be another monster to slay, more friends you will have to leave behind, and there are more people on this world than even I can protect, and I'm a god. You have done well, I'm proud of you. There is rest waiting. Avarid tells him, and takes another draw from his pipe. But only if you're done. Peregrine looks at him, looks to the door and thinks. He has lived a long life, 30 years. His body is starting to fail, the aches and pains of age are setting in. He's seen friends and family pass on and traveled under wind and rain, been driven out and fought to the death more times than he can count. He wants to rest, wants to go home to the golden fields. He looks at Avarid, his decision in his eyes, and the hero who became a god smiles at him. That's my boy. Undri finishes the chant, and the scroll dissolves, the diamond turns to dust and settles on Peregrine's scorched body. For a long, terrible moment, nothing happens. Then a brilliant light glows from every particle of gemstone dust. The scorched flesh begins to regenerate, overcooked organs start to beat again. Blood, newly synthesized from mana, rushes into thirsty veins. Obliterated nerve endings crawl like lightning across the sky to reconnect. When it is done, Peregrine looks just as he was before Avernius immolated him. His chest rises and falls with breaths, his heart beats, his stomach rumbles. He doesn't open his eyes, then does, stretching as though he is waking from a long dream. I'm not done. There is much rejoicing as the paladins embrace their smallest member, who laughs and hugs them right back. All right, come on, I was only dead for a moment or two, come on. There's still far too much of this story to go to be killing off the protagonist. He jokes. Although apparently the resurrection didn't extend to my gear, or my pants. Anyone got a towel? After finding him one of Kaz's spare shirts, which is large enough to be a dress on the small halfling, the party regroups and examines the vast hoard in front of them. There is far too much gold here for them to carry, but as they sift through it, they come upon several items of interest. Kazdor finds his missing axe and his hammer, and also pockets a necklace hung with rubies and more than a few of the precious stones for himself and as much gold as he can carry. Sivrid now rides more comfortably on his back, and he senses the cloak is in some form of hibernation, feeling it change and shift as it draws in the power of Avernius to take on a new form. Undri finds gold aplenty, but chooses to carry out a fine basket-hilted rapier. While not magical, that blade is silvered and of the highest quality. It fits easily in her hand, made in the elven style, but something about its design doesn't line up with normal elven work. There is no script work or naturalistic imagery, but rather a spider web pattern all along it. Julian keeps the gauntlet of storms, noting that light is already starting to come back into the stone. Even if the magic isn't active, the sharp points make it a savage weapon if his blade is lost. He also carries off all the Drowmage's research. Peregrine has no great need for treasure, and mostly looks for a replacement for his weapons and armor when Kazdor drags him away to take his measurements. Senkit though finds the treasure among treasures. Holy icons and reliquaries, all bearing the mark of Hearthfire, as well as one in a similar style, but not quite the same, she supposes might be for the chapel the paladins have made their unofficial base. It is in this reliquary that she senses magic, more powerful than anything else in the hoard. It is an unusually large jeweled box, decorated with scenes of heroes defeating various evil creatures. It does not open at first, and then she tries channeling her power into it. Then, the box whirs and clicks, opening to reveal an item of mighty power. The shattered shards of what was once a longsword, forged of some unknown metal. Even Kazdor and Julian cannot identify it, for it is neither metal nor adamantine nor anything else they know. The latter hypothesizes that it is some form of meteorite iron, forged from a falling star. No matter what it is, that blade is plainly magical. Even in the box it gives off an aura of holy power, and the shards glow with divine light. Kazdor examines the shards, but soon realizes that it is so heavily enchanted, and forged of such an unknown make, that only a legendary forge, such as that of an ancestral dwarf hold, could melt the blade down that it could be reforged. As for the kobolds, while the party seeks them out, it appears they departed immediately after the death of Avernius, leaving the one in the laboratory behind. When she regains consciousness, the party learns that her name was Mira, and she agrees to come with them back to Hearthfire. Before they go though, Kazdor has a project to finish. After a day and night of constant work, it is done. Peregrine walks forth from the dragon's mounting clad in magnificent scarlet-red mail, with two new swords at his side, sharp as the dragon's fangs they were made from.